Welcome again. I'm Pastor Michelle Allen at First Presbyterian Church in Williamstown, New Jersey, and we are continuing to walk through this Christmastide, the 12 days of Christmas that we celebrate the birth of God's Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, and we are able to reflect and ponder on the baby that was born in the manger. We are heading into the season of Epiphany, so I thought I would kind of jumpstart that for you a little bit, because there are many stories in the Bible and the Gospels about Jesus that we don't often hear about on Sunday mornings. So it's important for you to be in your Bible reading the Gospels. These are stories that are designated during Epiphany, which means epiphanos, to shed light upon, from the Greek. And it means to learn who this baby in the manger grows up to be. Who is this Messiah going to be? What is he going to be like? What is he going to do? So these are some of the stories that begin to reveal that to us. So I want to take you back to Luke, the second chapter, and I want to pick up where we left off from yesterday. We're going to pick up at verse 39 and read to the end of the chapter. And it's important to start at the beginning and get to the end here. So let's read that. When they had finished everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. Of course, that's Mary, Joseph, and the baby. So they have completed everything that God says to do when your child is born, and they go back to their home. So they spend some time there in Jerusalem to take care of his circumcision and his purification. And it says the child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. So Jesus is growing just like any other child grows, and he's getting stronger physically. He's filling out as a boy. And he's being filled with wisdom. Now, wisdom, definition of wisdom, again, all you Old Testament scholars, let's go here. You get an extra point today, maybe a gold star, if you will. Wisdom, the beginning of wisdom is what? The fear of the Lord. So it's, notice, it doesn't say Jesus was going to rabbi school. It doesn't say he was getting an education in the best schools in the town. No, it says he was being filled with wisdom. Wasn't just a data input kind of kid. It was wisdom. He was going to differentiate. He was going to know God. And because of knowing God and God's word, he was going to be able to be a wise person. Very important for parents to know that. And the favor of God was upon him. Of course, just like his mother, right? Because the angel comes to Mary and the angel says to Mary, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with the Lord." Now her son. So, now every year his parents went to Jerusalem for the festival of the Passover. Again, faithful father and mother. They went to church. They knew it was significant for them to be faithful to God. And so they're raising Jesus up in that faithfulness. So every year, it's time to go to the Passover. Passover is in Jerusalem. So no matter where you lived in Israel, you had to go to Jerusalem for the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, so now Jesus is 12 years old, picture that. They went up as usual for the festival. When the festival was ended and they started to return, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but his parents did not know it. Now, so, you know, a lot of people think, well, how did that happen? You know, when I get my kids in the car, I know they're in the car with me. Although we have had school buses, right, where kids get left behind, or unfortunately, tragic situations where parents forget their kids are in the car, but other than those, most people would say, I always know where my kids are. So here we have a situation where Jesus stays behind in Jerusalem and his parents don't know it right away. And most likely, you know, you're traveling with groups and family members and, you know, kids play with kids and you probably think, oh, well, you know, he may not be with us, but he's probably with Aunt Joe and Uncle Mary, or Uncle Joe and Aunt Mary. And, you know, he's coming along. We're all going back to town. So, you know, he'll be there. Well, so assuming, verse 44, assuming he was in the group of travelers, they went a day's journey. Then they started to look for him among their relatives and friends. When they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem to search for him. Imagine what they're going through here. Jerusalem's a big city. They come from a little town. They're missing their child. They only have one. Well, that may not be true, because we knew he had brothers and sisters, so he may have other brothers and sisters. But they're missing Jesus, and they better not lose Jesus. Okay. So when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem to search for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple. 3 days, we know 3 days is significant, right? After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. Oh, my goodness. Imagine if you lost your child and you found them back at school, or even better, back at church, talking with the pastors, or maybe the Sunday school teachers, and this kid is pumping them with questions and giving them answers. Pretty crazy. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. Remember, he was filled with wisdom because he feared God. When you fear God, God will teach you things. If you're waiting on God to be your teacher in life, you're going to learn things a lot of other people miss. It's the truth. So, all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. Yeah, because he's been learning from God. When his parents saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, "Child, why have you treated us like this?" She takes it personally. "Look, your father and I have been searching for you in great anxiety," as any normal parent would. "We thought you were lost. We didn't know what happened to you. For crying out loud, why did you treat us like this? You know you're supposed to do what we say to do. You know you should have been on the way back home, and you weren't. And your father and I are anxious. We're upset." He said to them, "Why were you searching for me?" You know, you got to love Jesus. Even as a 12-year-old, he's asking questions. You know, he doesn't just say, "Oh, Ma, oh, Dad." No, he says, "Why are you searching for me?" Imagine having a kid like that. "Why are you searching for me? Did you not know that I must be in my Father's house?" Oh, now, if you hear that as a parent, or as anybody, really, now he's talking from a whole different perspective here. Now he's helping his parents put everything in perspective as to what is going on with him. Jesus is coming from a different place here. But they did not understand what he said to them. They can't pick up on it yet. See, they're not going to see that yet. They're not going to understand it yet. "Then he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was obedient to them. His mother treasured all these things in her heart." So Jesus is obedient to his parents, but he is already beginning to see that he has a destiny that is more than just being their son. He is beginning to assume his identity as the Son of God. And that Son of God will be wiser than anybody else. He will have more understanding than anybody else. And he will always be the one who will provoke people in their faith by his questions. So again, this epiphany, God is shedding light on who is this baby now? He's 12 years old. What's he like? Well, now we're getting insight into that. But notice here in verse 52, "And Jesus increased in wisdom." He's going to increase in wisdom and in years and in divine and human favor. Notice, Jesus continues to grow. He's becoming a young man now, 12 years old. And he is increasing in wisdom. We know what that is. He's increasing in years. He's aging just like any other human being does. So you have both and going on. And in divine and human favor. He's got divine favor, which means he's got a relationship with his Heavenly Father that is strong. And he's got relationships with others. The social part of him is growing because it says he even has human favor. So Jesus, if you look here, you see him as a very well-rounded individual. He's socially appropriate. He's got a good relationship with God. He's physically growing in years, so physically he's doing well. And in wisdom, he's learning. So even mentally, he's learning about things through God's instruction. So it's a beautiful verse there in Luke chapter 2, verse 52, where Jesus is described as a very well-rounded person. And of course, we know he's got that special relationship with God that is going to be brought to the forefront even more and more. So, Jesus in the temple, wonderful story. He is beginning to attach a new identity to himself that maybe he has been growing into. Mary and Joseph are not quite getting it yet, but yet Jesus still remains obedient to them because he's still a child for them in their family. So it isn't time yet for him to begin his ministry and go off on his own. But he is heading there, and you can see the signs of that coming. So it's very important for us. I think that wisdom piece for each one of us, you know, the fear of the Lord is where we gain that wisdom. where we learn more about who we are. God helps us to walk into our identity in life. And everybody needs that relationship to happen so that we can figure out, why am I here on earth? What is my purpose? Who am I? Let God shed light onto who you are and your identity and your purpose in life, just like he did with Jesus. You'll have your own epiphany. And really, we've heard people say that, right? I had an epiphany. The light went on. That's where that all comes from, you know. So think about that, and let's pray about that for each other. Heavenly Father, we know that you have placed each one of us here on earth. We're here. You have brought us to the point where we are in our lives, and you have also brought us to this point where we are in our faith. Help us to grow in wisdom. Help us to sense your spirit. Help us to see the light that you are shedding upon each one of us in our souls and in our hearts, that we can identify who we are according to you and what you would have us to do in this life according to your plans for us. Lord, that is the most special gift that we can receive when we give ourselves to you, that we find our identity in you. And we are grateful for that. We're grateful to hear these stories about you when you were young. We've all been there as well. And it's good to hear these stories, whether as children or as parents, and or old members in the churches. Thank you for reaffirming our faith. Thank you for the insight that you give us. And may these stories always be powerful reminders that you are the Messiah, and that you would be fully revealed to be the fullness of who you came to be at the cross and at the empty grave. All blessings and all honor is yours, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And may God bless you today.